Real life horror stories are happening every day in the animal world, and they're starring parasites. And today with us, we have animal expert Lisa, and she's going to share some of these gruesome stories with us. Welcome, Lisa.
Thank you for having me today. Everyone uses the word gruesome when talking about parasites. I think that's really unfair. I think they're really inspirational. And I've got three examples of how they are inspirational. I'm going to change your mind about the whole gruesome thing. We just have to get past the part where they eat their way out of the live host and see the bigger picture. Okay?
Sure, I'm ready.
Okay, so the first that I'm going to tell you about, she's a really good mom. She's a type of parasitic wasp species called a jewel wasp. And she just wants to find a babysitter for her little babies. And she knows that the best babysitter is a type of cockroach. So she goes and finds a cockroach, and these are scuttly little guys. They're going to run away. But she can't have that because she needs a babysitter. So she injects this wasp in the brain, specifically into two separate areas, in a particular order. And because she does it this way, it means it takes away the wasp's fight or flight instinct, or the cockroach's fight or flight instinct. So it just sits there, and then she's able to lead it away by its little antennae to a place that's a little bit safer for her to lay her egg. So she brings it maybe to a burrow, for example, lays her little egg in there on the cockroach's abdomen, then seals up the burrow, and off she goes. Now, her little egg is quite safe. The cockroach is still alive. And then we get to the part where the egg hatches and the larvae burrows into the cockroach's body and eats it through to the inside. And then there's the bit about the cockroach dying. It's not really inspirational anymore, is it?
No, I've totally lost you in the inspirational part.
Should we try another one? Yeah. Okay, let's try another wasp species. Okay, so this wasp species doesn't want just any old babysitter. It wants a bodyguard for its babies. And I said babies because it's not one egg, it's 80 eggs. So this type of wasp finds a particular caterpillar from a particular species of moth, and it lays about 80 eggs in this little caterpillar. And the caterpillar does what it does best. For the next 2 weeks, it eats and eats and eats and eats and grows and grows. Then these eggs hatch, and then we have the bit where the larvae eat their way out of the living caterpillar. That has to happen. But the caterpillar actually stays alive. And then the babies pupate. They build the little cocoons. And then the caterpillar helps them by putting another little cocoon over them. So he like tucks them in. It's quite sweet, really. But unfortunately, the caterpillar isn't in charge of its own mind. It's actually being controlled by some of the larvae that remained in its body. And instead of coming out and, you know, completing their life cycle, they have selflessly given their lives to allow their siblings to survive. It's quite a, you know, inspiring story until the caterpillar dies again. Still gruesome. I'm not having much luck with wasps. So should we try another one?
Yeah, let's do.
Okay, so this one isn't a wasp. This one is a really nice story about a marine isopod, which is a little bit like a marine louse. It's a member of the crustacean family, so think lobsters, crabs, that kind of thing. So this little louse, it has dreams. When it grows up, it wants to be something. It wants to be a fish tongue. We all have dreams, don't judge. So the little boy babies go in and take up home, and it's usually a snapper, which is a species of fish. They take up home in the snapper's gills, and then they mature to become females. And now the gills are okay for the boys, but the females want something a bit more spacious. So they move to the mouth of the fish. Now it's very roomy, except there's a big tongue in the way, but that's not a problem. What the females do is they attach themselves to the tongue, suck the blood out of the tongue, the tongue withers away and falls off. And they have a nice bit of space where they can live and quite happily have some food. And they like to eat fish mucus. So if you like fish mucus, the fish mouth is the perfect place to live, really. And you're probably thinking, that poor fish, he doesn't have a tongue. But actually, the marine isopod acts like the tongue. The fish gets on fine. It can continue with its life. The female isopod is a nice place to live. It has a source of food. Her thoughts start to turn to romance. So if any of the males come along from the gill arches, move down to the mouth, they see she's got a nice place to live, they will mate with the female. Yes, it's in the fish's mouth. Let's get past that. And the whole thing starts again. It's actually a really lovely story with a very happy ending for everyone involved.
And this all happens in one fish?
Yes.
Okay.
Isn't it lovely?
It's lovely. You completely changed my mind on parasites. Okay, thank you Lisa. And for you guys at home, if you want to hear some more really inspirational stories about parasites, check out the article below.